If you want to come forward and take a seat, and we're going to get started. My name's James. I'm from Digital Rights Watch, one of the events, one of the organisations hosting tonight, along with Music Victoria. First things first, I want to acknowledge that we're gathering today on the lands of the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung people of the Kulin Nation. I want to pay my respects to elders past and present and acknowledge that sovereignty was never ceded. This week is National Reconciliation Week, which runs from the 27th of May to the 3rd of June every year. Those dates commemorate two significant milestones. The successful 1967 referendum, which gave the Australian government power over to create laws for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people and recognise them in the census, as well as the 1992 High Court Mabo decision, which abolished the legal fiction of terra nullius, paving the way for native title. We're here today to talk about how we can stand up for music and culture in the face of big shifts in the digital economy, as well as the power of big tech companies. In that spirit of struggle and resistance, it's important to acknowledge that the rich history and cultural significance of songs to First Nations people and the staunch history of First Nations-led resistance. From the Kamaragunja walk-off in 1939 to the more recent Muckaty campaign that successfully stopped a proposed nuclear waste site in Aboriginal land. The history of resistance isn't as widely known as it should be, and I want to point you all, and if you bought a ticket online, I've got your email address, so we'll be sending you emails about this tomorrow. But there's a great resource from Original Power called The Timeline of Resistance, which I encourage everyone to look at, and I'm sure you will learn something about the history of Aboriginal resistance on this continent. At Digital Rights Watch, we work on issues of technology and surveillance. Surveillance is a tool of domination and coercion. It is deployed by those with power to discipline the behaviour of the rest of us. And it lives hand in glove with the carceral system. So, of course, in the colony of Australia, that tool is disproportionately used on First Nations people. It is worth stating here that First Nations people on this continent built sophisticated systems of governance and trade that didn't rely on ubiquitous mass surveillance and incarceration, which serves as a reminder that the colonial systems that we live under are not normal or necessary, and they're certainly not natural. Colonialism in Australia is an ongoing project, and so is the work of resisting it, and that work falls to all of us. But we are here today to talk about music and technology. And while there is no shortage of surveillance and coercion in the music industry, I will let our panellists talk about that. Tonight is the final event in a series that Digital Rights Watch has been running called Rebalancing the Internet Economy. This project was developed in response to the News Media Bargaining Code and Facebook's decision to remove all news content from all Australian news content from their platform last year. And that whole saga really drove home for us the power that digital platforms have, as well as just how embedded they in our lives they have become. The first event in this series was called Exhibit. It looked at censorship and the role that platforms play in policing morality in the digital age. Imagine explored the written word and how platforms exploit for profit the human desire to share and write. Gather, which was our third event, looked at how civil society and political activism is shaped by the digital tools that we use, and asked whether social media is a tool for our liberation or whether it's standing in our way. The overall goal of this project is to understand how people use and experience digital platforms so that we can answer the question, how can we rebalance the internet economy so that a global internet works for local communities? You all have a role to play in that. That email that I'm going to pester you with tomorrow will also have a link to a survey. And we want to collect not just the experiences of our panelists and how they experience digital platforms, but also how you experience digital platforms. And I'd really encourage you to fill that survey out. And that will help us. We're going to be producing a report that will be available in the next month or so. We're getting to the end of this project. Tonight, our panel is going to be sharing their experiences with music in the digital age and how digital platforms are changing the relationship between the artist and the audience, as well as between labels, publishers, and music venues. I'm really excited that we're here to have this discussion. Music is a fundamental part of what it means to be human, and it's really important to me, as I imagine it is to everyone here today, and I imagine that's why you're here. Music teaches us about ourselves, our relationships, our communities. In cultures throughout history, song has played a central role in education, knowledge, and law. Music is fundamentally a part of us. But we live under capitalism. And our relationship to music is defined by capitalism. Music is sacred, but in this world it is treated as a commodity to be sold and consumed. Capitalism is alienating us from this very deeply important part of ourselves. In the early days of the MP3, which I am unfortunately old enough to remember, there was one joke in there. And that was about what I expected to get. There was a lot of hype about how the MP3 was going to liberate us and liberate musicians and audiences from a capitalist music industry. But now, decades later, that reality is very different to the hype. So how exactly are digital platforms changing the way music is created, distributed, and consumed? What opportunities exist to change that for the better? And what risks do we need to be aware of? With that, I want to throw you over to Kiwat Kennell from Music Victoria, who is going to be moderating our discussion. Kiwat is a proud Eastern Torres Strait Islander descendant from the islands of Yugaa and Irrawaddy and has spent 10 years in the music industry as an artist and a producer. And I'm sure he has also had many other roles that he'll talk to you about. Please make him feel welcome and he'll introduce you to the panelists. Thanks for coming.
Oh, Jesus, hit myself in the teeth right there. It's not the first time that's happened. All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you very much for the introduction. Yes, my name is Kiwat Kennell. I am the Community and Project Manager with Music Victoria. I've been in the industry for about 10... I don't know, can you count when you're from a kid? I don't know. But I've been in the industry for about 10, 15 years as a technician, as a booker, as an artist, still chasing that dream as an artist myself. But it's an honor to be here today and to talk about this amazing panel. And to kick things off, I would also like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, the Wurundjeri and Boonwurrung people of the Kulin Nation. It's always important to pay respects to elders past, present and emerging, and always acknowledge that sovereignty has never been ceded. It's such an honour to be here, to be a guest on these lands, to work here, to live here and to create. So always remember, always was, always will be Aboriginal land. To begin, our first guest for this evening is Eilish Gilligan. Eilish is a Melbourne-based producer, singer, and songwriter with over 1 million collective streams across Spotify alone. Yeah, you can... Dramatic entrance, it's great. In the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic, Eilish created a space for her community online through Twitch, streaming to thousands of followers and regularly featuring on the front page of the platform. She wrote, produced, and engineered her debut EP, Hospital, in 2020 and celebrated the release with a sold-out show at the Corner Hotel in January 2020. Awesome. Recently, she won the coveted industry-voted Best Producer Award at the 2021 Music Victoria Awards. Eilish also is the founder of Starcross PR, an artist-focused social media strategy and publicity company. Please welcome Eilish Gilligan, everybody. Yes, big round of applause. Welcome, welcome. It's a very impressive bio.
Thank you.
She's humble as well. I love it. Next up is Will Evans. Will is Bandcamp's artist and label ambassador for Australia and New Zealand. This is like a game show where it's like slowly. Bandcamp is an online record store and music community where passionate fans discover, connect with, and directly support the artists they love. In his role, Will works directly with artists and labels to enhance their experience using the platform and help spread Bandcamp's artist's first mission to the wider industry. Outside of Bandcamp, Will has worked as an agent, venue booker, label owner, artist manager, and festival director. He currently manages ARIA award-winning jazz psych band Mildlife. Please join me in welcoming Will Evans, everyone.
Hello.
Next up, we have the amazing Glenn Bennie. Glenn is a national education and outreach representative of APRA MCOS. His role is to support members on issues including music copyright in Australia and how musicians can earn money through the system of royalty collection, distribution and licensing. Glenn has also been an active musician in the local industry for over 30 years. Give it up for Glenn Bennie.
Thank you,
Glenn. And next up is Jake Cleland. Come on down. Yes. Jake is an information security consultant and former music critic. You can sit right here. It's okay. Yes. Over the past 10 years, Jake has reported on local music and culture for publications including the Sydney Morning Herald, Pitchfork, Broadsheet, and more, and appeared at industry conferences and panels to provide expert insight into the field of arts coverage. Jake has also taught entertainment journalism at CollArts, mentoring young journalists on building sustainable careers. He's been called one of Melbourne's most esteemed music journalists and a legend of Australian music journalism. So give it up for Jake. Hello, everyone. How are we doing?
Great. Thank you.
Good.
Yep. Good. Thank you.
Oh, that's it. That's it. I love it. It's such an impressive panel. Everyone's got amazing experience in what we're about to talk about. And, you know, let's get straight into it. You know, we're here to talk about digital platforms, about streaming, about, you know, exploitative paper stream models to the impact of recommendations and algorithms and building a listener base. And modern musicians need to do so much more than just make music. With the first question, I'll kick it over to you, Eilish. How have digital platforms affected the relationship between artists, labels, publishers, and listeners?
I mean, where do you want me to start? Like, the invention of the internet? I mean, if we're talking about just like this year, I suppose, we've definitely seen a lot of tension between, in particular, artists and labels. I suppose I think most people here would have seen the Halsey TikTok saga thing.
Yeah.
And I think something that's interesting that's happening because of the proliferation of these like digital spaces, TikTok and Twitter and Instagram and all of this stuff, is we're getting to see behind the scenes of what it means to be a major label artist in a way that we've never really had access to before. We always hear this stuff in hindsight, like you watch a Beatles documentary or a Rolling Stones or, I don't know, what's another old band, like whatever.
Old band. Classic.
Well, it's like you watch it on YouTube and it's like, they were screwed over by their label like so many times. Mm. And it's like, this is happening, like we're watching this 30 years after it's happened. Mm. But now, like literally the same day that Halsey is told by their label, like you can't release this song until you have a viral TikTok, we're getting that information in real time.
Yeah.
Which I think is really cool in a lot of ways. So I think that has kind of had a weird effect from label to artist, artist to label to fans, artist to fans, and that affects everybody in between. Mm. So, yeah.
And I suppose like it's we're getting a connection to artists on a very personal platform, you know, like across the socials, you have that ability to sort of connect with your audience directly and to hear about it from other artists such as yourself and from Halsey and from everyone out there. It's really good to sort of like see how people are reacting and also understand as an artist yourself what they're going through. And it must be interesting from for Will and Glenn what it's like from the sort of the industry perspective, like that, you know, on that topic of Halsey about pushing that sort of content. How do you feel, you know, is it the digital platforms doing it from that the industry perspective?
Yeah, I think what Eilish is saying is really right. And it seems like it's kind of exactly the same. It's just that the pipeline is different. These, like, major labels are, you know, can't speak for them, but whatever they're doing to push artists to do more stuff, you know, you watch these old documentaries and it's like, oh, we have to do a longer tour than we'd like to do. We have to do a bunch of PR that we don't want to do and we have to do to so that this label can make money or a return on its investment or however it's sold to the artist at the time. And then that's the same. That's still happening today, but that's normal and people like that. So, you know, if you're an artist today, you want to do PR because it's like, I'm getting in the newspaper or whatever. You want a tour because it's probably the only way you make money, but it's also fun. But you now also have these other platforms where you're like, I have to do something every day and everyone has to be involved in that. Every aspect, you have to be engaged in like my process and all that sort of stuff, which from an art perspective is kind of cool because I am interested in like the process of people's art making. But as an artist, like that's not my, I don't get that. I'm meant to just get the cool thing at the end to love and enjoy. So from an industry side, I don't know. I don't know why we have to do this, but for some reason, It is. I don't know. I have fairly negative opinions about most of the stuff we're talking about tonight. So I apologize in advance for that.
That's all right. That's a diverse panel. I love it. And your thoughts on it, Glenn?
Well, I think first of all, I'll talk from the perspective as a musician myself, which I have been for a long, long time. I find the digital world kind of liberating in terms of there's not that reliance on labels that we used to have, like growing up seeing bands in the 80s. Unless you're on a label, you didn't hear much about bands and releases. So nowadays, it's a lot easier for artists to, of course, get their work out there. Mm. And if you're prepared to do the work on social media, and then you can connect with that audience.
Mm.
Yeah. I guess in terms of like majors and how they deal with that, I'm not too sure. But I know the downside for artists is the return from digital platforms. And that's something as working for APRA AMCOS, that's a frustration for our writer members, you know, what they get back for per stream, you know, less than a cent per stream and that sort of thing. So there is that, the liberating factor of being an independent artist and being able to get your things out worldwide whenever you want to, without someone telling you when to do it and how to do it. But also the returns aren't that great, obviously. So there's that sort of balance. Like, is it for commercial gain, or is it another step for promotion? Because it's a step that in the 80s, I guess bands didn't have.
Mm.
You know, they didn't have access to that.
To that control, that sort of control over their own content.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because, like, you know, Spotify is amazing because it's access. Everything's there. You know, and yeah, it's terrible that it's 1 cent per stream, but we've got more control over our content than we've ever had before, you know, and it's hard though. We can't go back. Like, you can't go back to that. I mean, you can sell a CD, but who has a CD player these days? Like, I mean, my car doesn't even have a CD player anymore. It's just a media player. But it's it's interesting. But like with the digital platforms in themselves, especially with social media, you have control of your story. And for you, Jake, like, with your experience with journalism, is it interesting to find out stories via social media, or how is that for you in your experience?
It's a fucking nightmare. I want to challenge that idea a little bit that's so dominant that the situation we're in now offers more control to artists. Because the way that I see it is that at the dawn of like Web 2.0, which we kind of just call social media now, there were kind of two core promises. And one was like the promise of disintermediation. So this, like, you know, 60-year major label paradigm where everything was mediated through major labels and publicists, label execs, journalists, TV show hosts, whatever. Suddenly artists could go straight to their fans. Like, there was all these promises about like one-to-one relationships, meaningful relationships. If you've paid any attention to like Web3 or any of that crypto shit, you've probably heard some of this stuff recently. It's very familiar. And some of that materialized, right? Like, now Eilish can reply to one of my tweets and I get to tell my mom that I spoke to a celebrity, and it's like very exciting.
With the eye roll.
But so like the sort of communication channel is disintermediated a bit, but at the same time, it's not disintermediated in so many other meaningful ways. For example, now instead of like major labels kind of controlling all this stuff and artists having to regulate their relationships with fans through that process, there are all of these new mediators, like all these platforms. So now, you know, there was sort of this, I guess, like Wild West period in the early 2000s where, you know, Radiohead and Nine Inch Nails and like Harvey Danger were all selling their albums for like whatever fans wanted, and you could just go to this janky website and pay for it. And I was like, oh my God, like the future of music is actually like, I'm going to give $10 to a band and the band will get $10. That's crazy. But now you have all of these like tech companies that have come and inserted themselves and become mediators instead. And so from one perspective, you could be like, well, artists are still sort of ceding authority to these mediators, right? The faces have just changed. It's tech companies now instead of record labels.
Yeah.
The fucked up thing is the major labels still exist. So Now there's actually more mediators and more mediation than there used to be, except these mediators are even less aligned with artists' incentives, because I would like to think major labels are at least nominally interested in, like, artists getting paid.
Half the time they're owned by the major labels at this point.
Yeah, true. Mm. And the other promise is the promise of artist empowerment, which, like, we've kind of been talking around, like, accessibility and, like, everyone has access to all of these tools and communication channels and stuff and how wonderful that is. But they're also still disempowered in these other ways, because those communication channels are these platforms, and these platforms have, like, arbitrary content policies that often discriminate without warning against, like, queer people, women, like, artists of colour, any sort of marginalised group, and they will demonetize and deplatform you based on, you know, almost nothing, and you might not even be able to appeal that. Mm. So there are sort of these, like, these promises have sort of been, it's like a monkey's paw, right? Like, we got this stuff, but in kind of a really perverse way.
Yeah, it's kind of like we have a lot of the control, but also it's like we're putting in a lot of this effort. And as an any sort of creative, you put all of that energy in, and that you're not getting paid for those hours or that extra content that you're putting out there. You're not getting paid per hour that you're putting in for a video or for what you're creating yourself. It's not until you get to that peak point in your career where the major labels come in, and then it's then there's more mediators and everything.
Well, that's the thing, like, even when you get to that point of, like, you know, the kind of top end of town, right, the power and authority and wealth is still disproportionately afforded to these mediators, not the artists. There's no circumstance in which an artist is so powerful that they have more control over their output or their the comments of their work than all of these other entities.
And it's always evolving. It's always evolving, always changing. And there's new platforms coming up. Like, I love Bandcamp and what that gives back to the artists. And Eilish, you're also doing everything on Twitch. And Twitch is coming through as a really good source for artists to sort of get something back.
I feel like I should say that I'm actually on a Twitch hiatus at the moment. For a number of reasons. Mm. One, the main one was because I'm making my album.
Yep.
The second one was when things started to open up again and gigs were happening, I found that streaming for minimum 3 hours a week for 4 streams per week was completely unsustainable, like beyond unsustainable. Mm. And I think that is the top of the pyramid of things that don't quite work when it comes to Twitch. I love Twitch as a platform. I think it's a really, really special place, and I have had a really special time with it, and I plan to return to it because of that reason. But there are a few things with the Twitch culture. I should specify, if you don't know what Twitch is, it's a live streaming website. And mostly it's for video games. It was built for video game streaming. And there is a community of musicians and producers on there that stream their process, which is what I was doing for a couple of years until maybe like 2 months ago or something. And it was amazing. I managed to create a new income during COVID. I created all these, like, this amazing grassroots fan base, which is something that I think is really precious. And I also, like, got real life fans. A lot of my friends were very skeptical. A lot of my musician friends were kind of saying, like, oh yeah, but like, who's gonna come to a show? And then people did, and it was crazy. And all these people coming to my shows being like, I'm so and so from Twitch. And I'm like, oh my God. And it's beautiful, beautiful. The negative thing for artists, I think, is the time aspect. I was given advice from Twitch, like the Twitch people, that said Eilish needs to be streaming, to my manager at the time, Eilish needs to be streaming for at least 3 hours per stream, at least, because most people don't turn up until after the first hour, which is true. Like, it's just true. From my experience with live streaming and watching streamers that I enjoy, you are under the impression that they're going to be live for like 6 hours. So it's like, oh, I'll just like drop in while I'm working and then I can leave and I'll come back and they'll still be live. But when you're the streamer, like, it's a lot of work. Mm. It's a lot of singing if you're singing, which is what I was doing. And the revenue cut with Twitch is really bad. Like, sorry, Twitch, but it's bad. Mm. It's half, so you get 50%, and Amazon get the other 50%, which, you know. So there's some really fabulous things about Twitch, and there's some not so great things about Twitch, which I think each artist has to kind of weigh up.
Yeah.
For their individual.
It seems like there's some real world parallels to that, where if you, for example, are a cover artist and you're booked in for a 3-hour gig, you know, you play halfway through until you get to that second set.
Yeah,
that's exactly when everyone starts coming in to see you. So there are some real world parallels.
Totally.
So it's not just the glorification of just like, yeah, this is come see my Twitch stream, I'll play for an hour, give me X amount of dollars. It's not so much like that. There are some real world parallels. That's interesting because it's an interesting domain. And especially during COVID, like it's, you know, they said that necessity is the mother of all invention. It seems like at that sort of time and period, that's where that sort of grew and that there is that community out there. So it's good to know that there are those avenues. And it seems that you can get a further reach as well, both internationally with Twitch, which is something that you can't get as playing as on the ground.
That's the other thing. I don't want to come across like I'm really negative about Twitch. I think Twitch is amazing and it's been incredible for me. And one of the reasons is because of international reach. Like I have created this like little international fan base, which I never ever would have reached ever from like my Melbourne bedroom during COVID. So that for me was really remarkable.
That's like, yeah, it's interesting how we sort of adapt, you know. And I know that, you know, there's a lot of artists and a lot of people out there, especially with Spotify and the paper stream. It's really iffy, be the word, you know. And that's where I think where sites like Bandcamp come through, and it just gives more. Do you feel like that's what it's like?
Yeah, I mean, fundamentally it does. It is a different platform in that it's you're selling something. So, you know, I do these things, you know, well, not recently, but all the time, and if there's young people in the audience, people are kind of freaked out and weird that someone would buy a digital download, which, you know, and it is shifting more into, you know, buying merchandise. It's a little bit different in the last 2 years because of what everything's going on and what Bandcamp has done and what Bandcamp meant for people and how people knew that they were able to pay artists fairly directly. For anyone that does know, Bandcamp takes a 10% cut, and after payment fees and stuff, it works out to be about 86% on the dollar of what artists are getting back.
Which is a lot.
Which is a lot, over 50%. I didn't know Twitch did 50%. That's pretty crazy.
Somebody write these figures down.
Yeah. But yeah, I think, you know, Bandcamp seems to be, I don't know, I've worked there for 5 years and everyone's pretty great. And I also, you know, I do work there, so I'm going to say nice things, but you can make up your own mind. It seems like the only person in the game that's doing it for the right reasons. Bandcamp wasn't built for a like mass market, where all these other companies and platforms and stuff were built for scale and for a lot of people to be using it, and you to give a small amount of money and then get a lot of information back, which is kind of fundamentally unfair. But we all do it now, and so do I, and I'm a hypocrite. But I think that, yeah, Bandcamp is artist first, and it's in the mission that it's artist first, and that's like a whole corporate thing, but it is kind of true. And if you use the website or as an artist or a fan, you will know that that is the case. Mm. It is for the artist.
That's where it comes into that interesting conversation about sort of like Spotify has that access where everything is there, you know what I mean? And then there's like, you know, you've got the app, you can listen to everything. I remember back in the day, you mentioned MP3s. I used to have my entire iTunes library that I downloaded, that I curated, and I could put that all on my phone, and that was me, you know, and that was great. But then Spotify comes out with everything all just there, and you can think of a song and just straight away, it's right there. That accessibility is very handy. But how do we sort of get into that sort of domain where we can sort of get control back to the artists, where we can give them something that they really need, which is the money for the work that they're putting in? And there's a lot of different platforms coming in. We were talking earlier before, Glenn, about royalties coming in from sort of like reels, Instagram reels and TikToks and all of that. You know, is like, where do you sort of this might be a question for the end, but like, how do you feel about with the sort of royalties for artists on these new platforms? There's Bandcamp, Spotify, TikTok. Like, how do you feel about the royalties for these artists?
Well, I think Bandcamp is fantastic. As an artist, I put my stuff on Bandcamp, and it is a real direct sort of interaction with the fans, and you get the bulk of that money back as an artist. With APRA AMCOS, we're collecting for the writers. And as I mentioned earlier, yes, the royalty rates from digital are quite low. But the reason for that is we can only pay, share the royalties between the writers based on the license fee that's paid to us by each platform. So it cannot exceed that sort of license fee. So Spotify, for example, pay us a license. Each quarter they send us everything that's been streamed. And then those hundreds and thousands of streams have to be divided amongst this certain amount of money. So you can see why the royalty rate gets sort of watered down for digital streaming. So for us, digital royalties have only really been a thing since 2012, believe it or not.
Okay.
And since then, it's grown incredibly. So the digital world is a new world for APRA AMCOS. I mean, APRA's been around since the 1920s, and we've had deals with radio stations since that time. So the whole licensing with radio, TV has been years in the making. And these digital licenses are quite a new thing. And of course, APRA's always pushing for a better return in terms of license fees, but it's not mandated. It's not by the government or anything like that. It's a negotiation between Spotify in Australia, for example, Apple Music, and APRA AMCOS. So it's about trying to get a better deal for writers through getting a bigger license fee from those sort of companies. And those license fees are based upon advertising and subscriptions. So it's a percentage of that makes up the license, and then from that license it gets distributed. Like, you know, you get played on commercial radio, for example, you might earn between, you know, $10 and $20 a play.
Okay.
But they're only paying out each day, you know, 250, 300 songs. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you imagine the equivalent in Spotify or Apple Music. So it's so vast.
And the social media aspect of it is now, it's growing, like putting audio to reels, like we were talking about before in the green room, was it's interesting how it's like you mentioned that there's royalties you can get from those plays, but there's like millions of streams that you can get from these reels that are just quick, and it's a quick 30-second video with a snippet of it. It's almost like an ad break, you know, and it's interesting to get those sort of, like, do you want to tell us a little bit more about those sort of
Well, the whole TikTok thing is quite new. They've only recently been licensed. So so royalties from TikTok are only a very new thing. So there are platforms out there that are still not licensed. And it's the job of our team, One Music is our licensing team, to try and connect with those platforms. And first of all, tell them that they need a license because no one wants to pay the license, unfortunately, and tell them about the importance of songwriting and songwriters, and what the fact that their work being performed publicly needs to be rewarded. So, those negotiations are all ongoing, and as new platforms come on board, it takes some time for the license fees to fall into place.
And Jake, there's a interesting reporter, tech music reporter, Shiri Hu, has argued that the fastest growing revenue streams for artists is actually monetization of community rather than of copyright and intellectual property. You look like you're expecting this. making this a question of the attention economy rather than purely one of buying and selling art. You've written about this idea. And and you argue that the fundamental problem with the idea that social media has enabled direct relationships between content creators and consumers is that it is always mediated. You mentioned about this before with the mediators. And do you want to tell us a little bit more, like, about your thoughts on this? Deep breath.
Yes.
Yes.
I have complex thoughts about it, which is why I like wrote just a disgusting, interminable amount of words about it. But I guess the this like tweet kind of, I guess, like spawned a conversation on Twitter. I think Eilish might have been like a part of it, but a bunch of like friends of ours were, I guess, like talking about how revenue streams for artists are like transforming in the digital space. Quite applicable to tonight, you might say. And I think I'm a little like troubled by the idea that things are any different now than they used to be. I mean, there's this idea that I think like kind of a tacit disparagement of the idea that musicians like monetizing community is in some way more profane than anything they've done before. My argument is that like artists have never sold music or art because like you can't. Like they've only ever sold the commodities around art. Okay. Like art is, you know, codified ideas and emotions. It's the relationship that you have with an artist or between you and yourself or you and your friends or some experience that you have. It's not a thing that can be held or sold. The only thing that can be sold are these like signifiers, right? So traditionally, the idea of a musician was that you were selling, you know, tickets to shows or t-shirts or cassette tapes or CDs or vinyl records or whatever. And now you're selling like Twitch subscriptions or God help you NFTs or some bullshit like that. But fundamentally, like objectively, nothing is changed. It's only the shape of what is being sold. And Eilish kind of touched on this in her TikTok article for Refinery29, which is wonderful, by the way. And I think anyone who's interested in this stuff should seriously pay attention to Eilish because she's one of the most like thoughtful entrepreneurial musicians I know.
Fan.
Yeah.
Fan.
But yeah, this idea, I guess, that what is being sold is different is problematic because while some artists these days might be more adept, might like find it really hard to sort of like adapt to this new paradigm, right? Like they sort of came into music being like, well, I can like tour, that sounds really fun, and I can like make art for my records, cool. And then they're suddenly confronted with this new paradigm where they're like, holy fuck, I don't know how to make a TikTok. Like, I don't want to do that. This isn't music. And it's like, well, none of the other shit is music either, right? Yeah. Like, it's just that these are like the conventions of stuff that you make around music. Mm. And the corollary to that is that now these new like forms of product and commodity are in fact very well suited to different people who really hated the idea of touring or like had no visual design bone in their body, you know, but who were really good at like playing games or hanging out in hot tubs.
It's interesting, like this idea, especially with Halsey and about major labels forcing people to do things, and it takes away from the art. Like it's like you said, it's nothing to do with music, but some of them are forcing him to do it, you know? And it's, where do you compromise yourself as an artist? Like, have you felt like you've had to sort of compromise yourself when you're going to do Twitch streams? You said you had to perform for 3 hours because that's what they recommended. And did you feel like that was something you, A, wanted to do because you got something out of it?
No one was... The only reason I started doing Twitch was because I wanted to keep my chops up, wanted to keep my fingers sturdy. And my team at the time were like, hey, why don't you try this? And I was like, oh yeah, I know this platform. I watch like some things on this platform. I could do this for sure. And then I did it and it was amazing. So for me, that worked. I think the other thing too is you can break it down even further than what Jake was breaking it down in that... some things are going to work perfectly for some artists for a period of time. And then obviously life changes and things cycle and maybe that thing doesn't work anymore and the method has to change. So Twitch, honestly, I mean, like I say, I you know, plan to return to the platform when I finish my album and I have more time. So it wasn't something that I ever felt like I was forced to do. I think with TikTok, it's a little bit different because it's a lot more people are using it. The music industry is paying more attention to TikTok now than it is to Twitch from my...
Which blows my mind.
Well, yes and no. I think Twitch is still learning very much about music and how music can exist on the platform because it is built so specifically for video game content. Mm. Obviously, that's what it was built for. And when you're playing a game, obviously you can sit and play a game for like 5 hours, 8 hours. Like, I mean, it's a lot easier to do that than it is to like sing for 8 hours, you know. And yeah, so with TikTok, it's a little different because there is the... Or I suppose this is with all platforms. There is the internal pressure that you feel as an independent artist. I mean, like, I'm self-managed at the moment. I have no, like, label, like, peering over my shoulder being like, how many TikTok have you made today? but that's all coming from in here now because I have been conditioned to... take that on as an artist.
It's like it's a new age pressure for a new age artist. Like it's, yeah.
Yeah.
Eilish, I just want to ask. Okay, yes. So I was like bragging to everyone about how I was going to be on this panel with all these cool people. And my friend was like, oh my God, Eilish, I love her on TikTok. And I was like, really? That's so interesting. Like she was just like gushing about your TikTok content. I was like, does it make you more inclined to listen to her music? And she was like, no.
Yeah.
Which like, rough, what kind of rough. Fucking people do I hang out with? That's so weird. but I wanted to ask you, like, do you feel like working on those platforms actually like converts into listeners or something like that?
No doubt. No. But I mean, the short answer is no, but... The long answer is yes, but I think everything that you do as an artist in the digital space is like trying to shoot a goal in basketball. It's
sports
like
sports metaphor.
Yeah, it's like, especially if you're me and you're not good at basketball, every now and again something is gonna go off. And you're going to get it in and it's going to be like, fuck yeah, it might be like a viral TikTok. You might have a Twitch stream that goes really well one day and it is completely random. But that one chance is the thing that keeps you coming back and making the content.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there's that chance that maybe that one time you post a 30-second cover of you singing, like whatever, is the one that goes viral. Like... a good example is Greta Ray posted a, I think it was like less than a minute long cover of Vienna by Billy Joel. And it went off on TikTok, went crazy, has like 30,000 reposts or something like that. But Greta put the work in. Like she is posting TikToks every single day. Like she's posting like 3 a day. And if she hadn't been doing that, then it wouldn't have... She wouldn't have given herself the chance to go viral, which is like, it's like a gambler's mindset. It's like, the more I do it, the more chance I give myself to go viral and to get discovered and Atlantic's going to sign me, like whatever.
Is that the end game? Like, because the word saying, I'm like, what's the point?
Well,
I don't mean that in a bad way, but like, is that the end game? Is like, it's going to go viral and then something's going to happen? Because it seems kind of messed up that that's the, you have to do all this work. If Greta's doing all that work, putting all that in. And then something goes well, and then maybe because everyone's jacked on TikTok, some major label executive's gonna sign you, and then all the other problems of what we've been talking about become another whole issue.
Yeah.
Like, what is the end game of all of this?
I mean, it's a great question.
Do you want this microphone?
No, sorry.
That's a great question. That is a great question, though. It is.
I'm thinking it in terms of like monetization, which is potentially incorrect, but that is where I'm coming from.
For me personally, and I can't speak for every artist because obviously I can't, but for me personally, somebody on my team once told me that it was like a very industry kind of meeting, and they were like, Eilish, we need to start marketing you more as like an internet personality rather than just like a musician. And it sounds so stupid, but I really took that on board because in this world, I started to understand that as an artist, as a musician, I needed to have something about me that nobody else had and nobody else could offer. And unfortunately for me, that is my stupid sense of humor that nobody else has. It's the only one, it's one of the only things that I can offer to people that is uniquely mine. And I was like, okay, so how am I going to like express to people that I'm like a fun person to follow? I'm an interesting person to follow. I'm an interesting person to pursue. I'm an interesting person to keep around. And hope, cross my fingers, that one day I'll become so interesting to them that they will click the link in my bio and listen to my new song. So that's kind of been the game plan for maybe like 3 years at this point. I've just been like, how many social media platforms can I get on and prove to people that I am interesting as fuck to follow so that they are inspired to listen to my music? And if people are interested in you as well, if you offer them a connection, they're going to be more likely to not only listen to your music, but to make listening to your music a part of their personality because they like you as a person. So that has kind of been the game plan with the stupid TikToks. Obviously not working very well yet, according to Jake. But that's fine. I think also the other thing, this is a very cynical, sorry, I'm taking up a lot of real estate. The other thing that I think is extraordinarily cynical, but is just part of the conversation. The gatekeepers, I suppose, whoever you choose to believe that is in the music industry, are very, very interested in the size of your fan base. They want to know how many followers you have. They want to know, can they like
capitalize on
your brand? Yeah. So if I get like 10,000 followers on TikTok, then I can go to, you know, a label or whatever and be like, hey, look, I have like all these followers and I know how to get more followers.
Yeah.
So you should sign me.
They want you to put in the work so you can capitalize on it.
Yeah.
And it's...
it's a broken system, but you got to work it somehow.
But to go back to what you're saying, and as a sort of wrapping things up, Jake, about that concept of that, nothing's really changed. You're saying that Greta Ray put in all that work and put in every TikTok. Isn't that quite equivalent to the real world parallel where it's like you play that cover gig, you go back to the 90s, like you play that gig. Oh, who was that in the audience? It was that major label. It's still that same parallel. There is that same formula that exists within that. And...
yeah, I think that's true. And I think the like corollary to that also is that, as Eilish said, it's a broken system. And the part that I fundamentally disagree with is the second part, that like you have to work within it. Fuck that. We should like destroy all of these platforms unequivocally. Like they're just like so bad for all of us. So I think like that's a very astute point. Like, you know, this sort of like traditional idea that you got to be in it to win it is still kind of part of the paradigm. And as Eilish said, like you're looking back at like these documentaries of like 50 years ago and oh my God, we're having all the same problems now. Well, like in 50 years time, we're going to be watching the documentaries about today where people are like, oh, the platforms didn't serve us at all. It was all complete bullshit. All the metrics were totally specious, if not outright lies in the case of Facebook and their video engagement. So yes, if like the problems are still the same, we should completely fucking burn everything to the ground.
I think what I was going to add was my age demographic. A lot of my friends and colleagues and people I work with, not at APRA, but in the music industry, they only... have Bandcamp, that's all. And because of their distrust of all of these other sorts of platforms. But my theory is that there's so much variety there now compared to when, you know, I first started out as a musician, that you can, you're not required to have to do all of these things unless you're with a major label, perhaps, who are forcing the issue. But you can pick and choose, you know, what suits you. And I think it depends on where you are in your career and what your ambitions are and that sort of thing. So I think it just opens up more scope. That's all I think about the digital world. And there's, I mean, you know, TikTok and whatever, it's not my thing personally, but, you know, it's working wonders for people.
Can you pick and choose? Can you pick
There's so many options. Like, I mean...
But what if Bandcamp, like...
was the only one.
It's, like, irrevocably changed tomorrow because of their, like, major media ownership, you know?
We're not talking about that.
Sorry, Will. Sorry, Will.
Well, I guess that is a great segue into the last question that I'll open this up to all the panelists. You know, like you mentioned, 50 years from now, what do you feel would be the platform or the projection... that magic question for artists to connect and start living off their art. What do you think? Put it out there. Whoever wants to raise their hand and go first.
I will go first.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I've been pretty negative tonight, so I'm not going to have too much hope for anything. But I don't know. I think it's just it's kind of the same as like when you buy a newspaper, you have to have some knowledge of what the angle or bias is of that newspaper. I don't know, maybe not everyone is able to do that, but like when you use these platforms or whatever, you need to understand that they're like owned by a company and they were made to fix a problem, because that's what apparently a starting startup is. But that problem wasn't, well, it was sold to the music industry as like, we're going to fix, well, this is streaming specifically, but like, we're going to fix piracy, which was not really actually a problem to begin with, but apparently it was. And then, it was already broken before that. You know, we can get into that another time. But then, so that was the solution. But in actual fact, it was a solution so that we could pay a small amount of money to have every single thing in the world. And that's wrong, fundamentally. We don't need that. How many times are you just doom scrolling on Netflix or any of these like streaming platforms of whatever media it is? And then you're just like, right, I'll just go to sleep. Like, we don't need all that stuff. So hopefully, we'll be able to find a place, whether it's me, I don't care what platform it is, but a thing that's like, well, we're going to buy something, and whatever that piece of content, if we're even calling it content 50 years, whatever it is, it's just, it's not some kind of consumerist thing to serve the user. It's there to serve the person who made the actual, I don't want to call it content, music. Mm. So that's what I hope happens.
Yeah.
I don't know if it will happen, but I hope it does.
Glenn?
Oh, well, I think if digital platforms are here to stay, I'd like the terms and conditions to be more transparent and easier for people to navigate, because at work at Bramcos, we're always dealing with members who... have thought they've read them properly, but there's always these little catches, like, you know, you might want to sign up to a distributor like CD Baby to get your music out, and they sign up to the pro version only to realise they're now being published by CD Baby, and that, so then they take a percentage of your royalties from Amcos. So there's all these things that people, in an effort to want to make a mark and get a foothold in the industry, they're sort of going for these things. But I feel like these platforms are making it really difficult to understand what's behind what they're actually signing.
What their rights are.
Yeah, what their rights are. Mm. So we tell people, you know, you've got to read the terms and conditions. Make sure you do that. And if not, we recommend them to Arts Law, which is an organisation that's there for artists that will help you with any sort of legal queries. That's what we can do for them. But of course... I don't know. So I don't read the terms and conditions all the time on things, I must admit. And that's really hard, and people are really impatient and want to get their music out there. Mm. So I don't know. That's not a big solution for the future, but it's like, you know, there's got to be more accountable or something in terms of what people are signing up for.
Yeah, and not... You know, not every artist is a lawyer. You're not going to read everything. You just want to create.
Yeah, or have the money to go and get checked out by a lawyer, especially if it's so easy as signing up online.
Yeah.
You know, oh, yeah.
Have you read the terms and conditions? No, tick. Yeah. And just go. Yeah. 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 And your thoughts, Jay?
Yeah. So Glenn and Eilish have to deal with, like, the day-to-day kind of, like, immediate concerns, for which I like greatly sympathize because I'm so unburdened. And so I know it like probably seems like a joke when I'm like, yeah, we should fucking kill everyone and put label execs up against the wall. Ha. But like, I'm serious. maybe not the last part so much, although there are some label execs I don't like very much. But yeah, I'm like kind of free to think like a little further in the future because my livelihood fortunately doesn't depend on it anymore. But I think there are a couple of things that need to be addressed. And I'm actually really excited about this question because so often, you know, we're all probably familiar with the panel format and how it's like, well, we started the conversation and we're starting conversations for like 30 years and nothing gets done. Because I think there actually are some solutions in this case. Like one, if we want to support artists and actually empower them to like have an equitable deal in the sort of like digital economy, how about a universal basic income? Like how about progressive social welfare programs? Yeah. Artist issues are workers' issues. And if an artist doesn't have to worry about like paying their rent or how they're going to put food in their mouth, they're much more empowered to make decisions about their art rather than having to like scramble for fractions of a cent from Spotify.
Or work a shitty job that they don't have.
Totally, yeah. Or if that's not going to happen and our taxes aren't going to pay for that, then maybe just reorienting our thinking as a culture. And I think that's kind of one of the benefits of these platforms in a kind of backdoor way, is that they have hopefully started adjusting people to the idea of subscriptions and divorcing like paying to get something tangible in return. Like that is an abhorrent idea that we have to do away with completely. I personally don't care if I pay an artist a bunch of money and get a song in return. I would just like to give an artist money, hopefully on a recurring basis if I can afford it, know their like material circumstances are taken care of, and they'll produce something fucking amazing when they're ready to, you know. They don't have to like capitulate to being on these platforms that they might not be ready for or don't have good ideas for. They can do it if they want to. Pretty radical idea. And the third thing is, I watched this incredible talk by Digital Rights Watch's Samantha Floriani earlier today. Shout outs. Yeah, I'm sort of like suckling the hand that feeds a bit, but gross. And it was about techno-solutionism and data-positivism, which were concepts that I wasn't familiar with, but it's kind of the idea that like if we just collect all of this data and more data, eventually we'll have enough data to make correct decisions, like these kind of prophetic good, maybe even moral decisions, and it's used to justify collecting ever more data. And now we know there is all this data out there for everyone to take, and so a lot of these conversations revolve around like, well, how do artists get a piece of that pie? Like, how do we kind of figure out the algorithm for ourselves so that we have access to this trove of information that's in the hands of these like grubby platforms? Sam was, I think, correctly very skeptical of that concept, and we also need to be very skeptical of that concept. We need to just completely move away from this idea that like big data or like capitulating to these algorithms or platforms is an innate good. And with that, try and avoid this idea of like there's a tech solution to it. Like some startup fucking Elon Musk dickhead is going to come in with like a cool app that's going to fix everything and we're all going to make a lot of money. No. But I think there needs to be a technical component to this, of course, because there are a lot of like wonderful functions that come with social media and the web, things that I would love to have, like the ability to send nudes very quickly to my friends. However, those entities need to be in the control of artists. They need to be developed alongside artists in our artistic community. And if you want like a tangible kind of example, I think something like Mastodon is a really great example. This is like a decentralized social network. People can run their own like instances. So it's like you all have your own little version of Twitter that all your friends are on. But like my people on my version of Twitter can talk to the people on Will's version of Twitter. Or if I don't want them to, they can't. And so we all manage our own instances of our community. Right. And so it's, I think, very easy to see how that could apply to the artist community and how these platforms should be artist run. And I think that's like kind of a scary idea because like, I don't know, Eilish maybe doesn't want to like become a fucking forum moderator / software developer and all this other shit. Like, artists probably just want to focus on making their music, and that's cool. And I think would be ideal. This solution doesn't result in artists like getting to go back and just work on their music, right? It's going to be work. Like, if things are going to be artist run, artist owned, which I think they should be, it's going to take work from artists. It's going to take work from everyone with this community oriented mindset, which sucks to hear, right? But as we've been talking about, artists are doing a lot of extraneous work right now. It's not working for them. And so I think it would be much better to reorient things in such a way that that labor is redirected in a way that artists are actually in control of what is actually happening.
Make some really solid points there. And when you started talking about, you know, my page and I want to do this, and it reminded me of MySpace back in the day where you could customize everything. And it's a bad joke, I know. So
that's what I meant.
Yeah. But it is. It is that. And it seems like the future forward might be a change of thinking rather than just an app or a platform or something like that. And that's definitely a solid point, that artists need to get paid for the work that they do, both on the clock and off the clock, because it's just, you're always working then. And Eilish, before we ask some questions for the audience, your thoughts on these?
I try not to be too negative because I don't want to be jaded. I think it's important not to be. So I like to think that the future might look kind of like Jake was saying. I really want to surround myself with artist-focused, artist-run, community-run things. I think that's extremely important. I don't know. I think it's important for artists to give things a try. Try TikTok, try Twitch, try whatever the new, because they cycle these apps. There'll be a new one in 3 years and we'll all be like, everyone has to get on Floopy or whatever it is. And
patent pending.
Yeah. Yeah. No one take that. And I think it's important for artists to remain open-minded and kind of be like, you know what, maybe I will try this. Like, I think it doesn't help really anyone to kind of be, you know, digging your heels in the ground all the time and being like, these guys suck, I'm not even going to try it. Because you might find that, it actually is fun and it actually works out. So I think artist-run spaces, artist-run businesses, definitely, that is very future-facing, and I think that's really, really important. And I really want our community to uplift artist-run things. I think that's really important too.
Absolutely. Artists helping artists. That's where it's at. It's how it's always been done, you know. And it was interesting in the pandemic when everything sort of collapsed that we sort of all had to support each other, you know. And it's good to see that adaptation is still there and creativity is still there. And thank you. Before we close it off, I want to thank everyone here on the panel. Is there any questions from the audience out there? Straight up, right in the middle there. Roving mic. Cool. Give it up for the roving mic. Yes.
So, hey, I'm Ash. I'm currently, I guess I'm the band leader and kind of sort of strategist for my band called The Clever References. And thanks. It is a funny name. The Clever References. So I'm surprised that there wasn't any discussion about just returning to a humble email list, because that's kind of sort of so I'm in music marketing circles and we're always kind of sort of scheming and, okay, so how do we navigate this algorithm or whatever? And so we're in a band, we are four people working shitty jobs or whatever, and so our current strategy is we're spending social media marketing ads on Facebook and TikTok, definitely not the thing you were talking about just now. And we have this kind of sort of Rube Goldberg machine where it's the ad is going to convert to a gate, the gate's going to convert to Spotify, and Spotify there's going to be a zero offer from Shopify, and the zero offer is going to be an email list where we send emails every, or whatever, right? And that's kind of sort of our version of Twitter or whatever. It might not interact with any other version of Twitter. But I'm just surprised that there wasn't any discussion about like the email list. And I wanted to ask you guys, what about the email list?
I don't know who would like to go.
I think like the email list is amazing because you can be... I think the most important thing about social media, putting my like publicist hat on, is that you offer the most authentic version of yourself you possibly can through that. And I think email is a great medium to do that. You can write straight from the heart and send it straight to your fans. I would... Did you say you were spending like money on TikTok ads and things like that?
Well, currently we've been getting like a really good conversion. Sorry, conversion rate. That's nerdery stuff.
It's all right.
Essentially, it's just like I think we are at like 37 Australian cents for each person that goes to the Spotify playlist, and that's pixeled. So like that kind of sort of strengthens our position in the algorithm, quote unquote. And that would kind of sort of funnel down into like people who actually sign up for our email list, where we're offering like our live album like for free or something like that.
Okay. Anyone have anything?
I think with email list is a great idea. Like, of course, go for it. I mean, that's how we communicate in the industry. Mm-hmm. You know, that's how we all got these invitations, and you know, it's. I don't see why it's not. It's a really great point, and of course. But I guess it comes down to filling that email list, getting that. Isn't this very similar to getting followers and getting, you know, people on your streams and getting people sort of like coming to it? It's very similar to that. And like you said, Eilish, about you get that direct connect. You get to get the most authentic version of yourself on social media. And maybe that's why email lists get overlooked. I mean, how many people have subscribed to an email list? I mean, I can't remember the last time that I did, but it is still a great opportunity to do it. Especially, maybe that is just an exclusive thing that you can have as part of the services you're offering as an artist.
Yeah, I think you want to make sure that people want to be on that list is like number one.
And not getting spammed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Most of our email list actually has come from a free offer.
Cool. So those people probably will care. And that's the thing. It's like, we just broke Bandcamp. That is one of the things that you can do, is get all the email address, or people have to opt in, obviously. We're not stealing it. But, yeah, I think the band that I manage, we don't do very well on Spotify. I don't do very well on social media, but we sell a lot of records and we sell a lot of tickets. Mm. And we have a lot of email addresses that we have. We have a specific email address that people can email at any time to contact the band. They're not talking to me, but pass it on. But, you know, that stuff is super, super valuable, and it means that if you do press a bunch of records, again, I'm talking very specifically about selling things, you know, you don't really have to worry about doing all this stuff because there's already people that really want to do that, and you can just turn that around super quickly and be like, great. So I definitely email addresses, but get them from the people that actually want to be there.
I think also, sorry to jump in, I think also I would focus more on, like, encouraging like organic engagement rather than like paid for engagement. Just because like you need that money for making music and living. I reckon put it towards that. And then once you gain a bit of momentum, I would maybe think about putting it back into paid spend. But yeah, organic reach is everything.
If you don't mind me asking, on top of that, like if you're just starting out and you're trying to get your followers and everything increase, would you recommend doing paid ads as to start?
No,
just try that organic reach.
I would be, again, like I said, like I would just be showcasing your authentic self, like exactly who you are on every social media platform that you enjoy using, and the followers will come because you're a cool person.
Cool. Great advice. That's a great question. Thank you. Another question?
Got a couple. I just also want to time check because Eilish has prepared a performance for us that I want to make sure we have time to do. So can we keep the question short and the answers short-ish?
Thanks. I want to draw on something that Jake and Eilish was talking about with REs. And sorry, I'm not an artist. I'm a practical person. That what is the role of democratic organisations, whether that's the state or representative organisations like Music Victoria, in minimizing that administrative governance, marketing, shared services work that goes into creating art so that you can focus on doing the thing that matters?
It's something that I haven't thought a lot about, and I think that's because I've been so consistently let down by the state. I'm aware that I'm kind of like the tech bro on this panel, so to be like, fuck the government, private enterprise, is like a pretty bad look and also not at all representative of my values or ideas. I guess sincere response is that I honestly have not spent any time thinking about that, like the state's role in this kind of thing, because I believe that it can only emerge from local communities. If you have any ideas about like the role that government and like government bodies can play, I'd love to hear it.
I guess from Music Victoria's sort of point of view, it's, you know, we advocate, celebrate and support live music, and we want to connect what's available out there. There's obviously, you know, there's a lot of grants that are out there that people can apply for, but like you were mentioning, until there is something where, you know, the Greens had that system where it's like we can pay for your sort of time and get a wage in there for artists, I guess that's sort of like, it comes down to your personal opinion, who you're sort of supporting in your politics. But you know, it's those sort of things. At the moment, there's grants that come out and we can connect you to those. I guess it's, in my personal opinion, in my views, I think that's a great idea to get wages for artists. That it definitely should happen, given how much we give out to the community and the support that we give. That definitely goes there. But I guess it comes down to sort of your personal preferences. And if you're talking about organisations and governments, I guess, yeah. I mean, that's just sort of my views on that.
I'm not sure I 100% understand the question, but I'm excited, potentially, cautiously, hesitantly looking forward to being an artist under a Labour government, because I've not been an adult under a Labour government before. So I'm interested in that. That could potentially be a great thing, could potentially not change anything at all, who knows. I am also really, I've got to say, like over the last 2 years, I have looked to like Music Victoria Support Act for support, and I have received it, which I think is like a very, very important thing, particularly like Music Victoria, get the emails, read them, read through the opportunities, love that. But Support Act, I mean, they have a counselling service. They have, I got several grants from Support Act to support me through COVID.
Yeah, I got a few as well.
And it really, that changed. I've not received any kind of government support, except maybe like JobKeeper, that really took so much weight off my shoulders. Mm. Like it made a huge difference to me when I got that. So I won't ever forget that. That was one time where I really felt supported as an artist.
Yeah.
Can I just add to that, actually? That totally reminds me. The Labour government thing is so interesting. And I think like, I feel like a lot of the people in this room are probably like music people rather than kind of like tech people per se. But something that'll be familiar to like Digital Rights Watch watches will be the like e-safety office and the basic online safety expectations, which is this like legislation, this kind of like weird office that exists at a federal level that has like dire ramifications on Australians' access to the internet. And so going back to what I was saying before about like how these platforms will arbitrarily demonetize and deplatform artists, now those artists and the audience, like us, are kind of facing that interference from the government itself, because, you know, these conservative common denominator content policies that previously were the domain of these private companies are now becoming like enshrined in like government censorship of the internet. Mm. So that's one way that I think like the state could serve the empowering artists and the future of music is by really critically re-examining that stuff and trying to take a very progressive view of it and openly communicating with relevant stakeholders and experts in the field, which they haven't done so far.
Yeah. Who do we lobby?
Sam, Floriani at the back.
And I think we've got time for one more question.
I think
one quick one.
Yep. One more.
One more question. Yep.
Awesome. Oh, sorry.
No, he's waiting patiently.
Hi, I'm Craig. I've been a band manager for all of 1 week with two awesome bands, so wish me luck with that in my late career change. Yep. Showing my age here, but 24 years ago, I worked for Telstra, and I did a digital music strategy. And every way I looked at it, the main opportunity for artists was going to be subscription income, which guys like Bowie, Prince, a guy called Todd Rundgren were pioneering at the time. 24 years later, we've got a thing called Patreon, which I've kind of looked at, but I'm glad you raised it because that was kind of the missing link for me. Why isn't anyone talking about Patreon? Can I just have some feedback from those who have tried Patreon and how good is it and what's its pros and cons, please?
I mean, look, I've had limited experience with Patreon, but I think it comes down to that sort of who's using it. And like when Spotify sort of kicked off, not many people were using it at the start, and then it sort of just got traction, and then it sort of goes like that. I mean, Patreon is fairly new, I think, is it? A couple of years. And I only started hearing more about it during the pandemic. And yeah. And so it just hasn't caught that traction yet. Maybe that's just my views on it.
I am a avid Patreon subscriber of a few podcasts and I think two musicians. I think if you're interested in looking at how Patreon can be used for your artists, I would look at Hatchie, a Brisbane artist who uses Patreon, and Jaguar Jones also uses Patreon in a really, really cool way. And I think Patreon's great because it's very this is a bad word, but it capitalizes, quote unquote, on the fact that people who really love music and really love musicians are gonna wanna support their favorite musicians. Just like Jake was saying, even if you just give them a bunch of money and all they do with it is make music, I think that is really, really cool. And I think Patreon is a great platform to encourage your artists to use if that is the platform for them. I mean, it's like any other social media platform, really. You have to create content for it. Mm. But, yeah.
I think Eilish is absolutely right. Actually, I'm so glad that you kind of, elucidated both, facets of it. That, it is sort of part of this paradigm of, people who want to just pay artists to live. But also, there is that element of, you kind of have to play its game a little bit. And so, yeah, I think the Patreon model is wonderful and hopefully adjusting people again to this idea of engaging with artists commercially that way. But again, I think Patreon itself has a history of kicking people off its platform for violating its terms of service. And those violations were because they were queer or sex workers or whatever, people who didn't do anything wrong. But their content violated, again, this conservative common denominator. Mm. And so if there's anything that I would like anyone to take away from my just exorbitant sucking up of air and time on this panel, is that something like Patreon is great. Patreon itself fucking sucks. There should be a version of Patreon that is owned and run by the artists themselves. And not the artists like a collective, but the artist.
Well, I think I think that's it for today. Can we get a big round of applause for our panelists, ladies and gentlemen? Give it up for Jake Leland, Glenn Bennie, Will Evans, and Eilish Gilligan, who's going to be performing for us very shortly. So grab a drink, enjoy the set, and a big round of applause for our organised digital rights watch. Give it up for James and Sam, please, very much. Thank you. My name's Kiwat Kennell. This has been great. Thank you.
Hey everybody, it's me again. Thank you for sticking around if you plan to stick around. I can also be nice background music to your drinking, so please feel free to chat and go for it. I'm just going to play a few songs. I'm not going to play for very long. I prepared about 5 songs across like my discography, so we're gonna jump around a little bit. The first song I'm gonna play is called Up All Night, and I put it out last year, and it was kind of written about the last party that I went to before the pandemic started, and it was a party that I felt that I probably should have stayed at a little bit longer. I was just getting over a breakup, really needed it, but I felt bad and yucky, so I left early. I actually wrote like a whole EP about it, so had a lot of time in the pandemic thinking about that night. Lady Gaga's Stupid Love had just come out, and somebody that I'd just met was like, Eilish, come dance with me in Stupid Love, and I had my backpack on, and I was like, no, I'm going home. And then I didn't go to another party for 2 years. Really cool. I've been here before, making up my mind. Halfway out the door, washing on the line. Group chat is a strobe light. There's always things to do. Big call, but I just might forget I'm not with you. I'm better than before, like 85%. You're not my every thought, only now and then. Say yes to the invite, replace you with a friend. 'Cause I'm up for a big night that's never gonna end. I can see the street lights cheering me on, skipping every line. They're playing our song up all night. Not thinking of you, dance all night. Not thinking of you, up all night. Not thinking of you, 'cause when I close my eyes, I'm thinking of you. Someone hold the door, I'm going in again. I'm scared of getting bored, or worse, the boring friend. Trip up on the carpet, but got away with it. I feel sick, but I like it. I
temporary hit. I can see the street lights cheering me on. Feel it through the walls. Been way too long up all night. Not thinking of you, dance all night. Not thinking of you, up all night. Not thinking of you, cause when I close my eyes, I'm thinking of you, up all night. Not thinking of you, dance all night. Not thinking of you, up all night. Not thinking of you, cause when I close my eyes, I'm thinking of you.
Watching so intently. I have to go to a gig after this, and I'm kind of hoping that the audience is this intent. It's so nice. This is another song about that same party. There's a lack of things to write about in the last 2 years, telling you that. I really had this fantasy dream wish that this guy would come to this party and I could like corner him in one of the, you know, rooms of a house party and tell him exactly why he sucked so bad. But I couldn't because he didn't go to that party, which was unfortunate. So I wrote about it anyway. And I wrote about everything that I wanted to say but never have. The song's called When You Forget Me, by the way. Also, this is a very different version. So if you look it up on Spotify being like, oh, that beautiful song that she wrote, and you get like, dunk, 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 dunk. It's the same song. Don't worry. Just keep listening.
The bar Fitzroy is the same. Nothing's changed in that place since we kissed on our very first date. And of all people I should know, I go there alone trying to get back in touch with a ghost. When you forget me, I hope it comes easily. I hope a scalding hot shower, a 4-hour nap does the job. When you forget me, I hope nothing's left behind. Like a bobby pin sitting behind an old box in your room. I hope that wouldn't do things to you. So I stand in my bathroom on my own, places you kissed me are marked up and inked to the bone. Baby pink, your soft-lipped tattoos. Not a laser on earth that could erase the memory of you. When you forget me, another will come along. We'll keep circling cities and I'll keep on singing my songs. When you forget me, I hope that it feels complete. I hope when you're buying the roses, they don't make you think of my lipstick or remind you of the weight of our kiss. Every word in the night, half awake, yellow light. No matter how hard I hold, it'll go. No matter how hard I try to write down, every time you made me blush on the phone, it'll go. The future laid out before us, trying to unfold. The future laid out before us, trying to let go. When you forget me, hope becomes easily. I hope it's simple and quick, and like nothing it has been for me. When you forget me, I hope nothing's left behind. I hope we meet in a year at the back of a coffee shop line. I hope it doesn't feel like you're mine.
Thank you. For anyone who's like, oh, she'll probably play a happy song now. No, no. No, no, no. This poor guy. This is another song about the same guy. We broke up a couple of times and yeah, you get it. Bless him though. One time we were like... my family have this thing where if I have a new song coming out, it's being on the radio for the first time, that we like hang out and like listen to it. And he came to one of these occasions and of course the song was about him. And my Nana was like, oh, it's just so great. Like blah, blah, and like made some allusion to the song being about him. And he was like, well, you know, at least she got something out of it. Like referring to the breakup that we'd had like 2 months prior. So bad. If you ever need a cringe, I have plenty of stories like that. So this particular breakup, we ended the relationship. He had to go on tour dating musicians, so romantic. And we kind of agreed that we weren't going to talk for like 2 months while it was on tour. and I didn't handle it very well, apparently. I hope you're happy now. I hope you sleep on the plane. Maybe you'll get a whole row. You know I would die to know. December in a dream to me, but I can feel it. I feel it. Every hour it takes you further away from me. Every time I said I love you, it was real to me. So I wait by the phone. Though you agreed that it won't come. We've seen the worst of it now. Funny calm settles into place. Maybe you feel it too. All alone in a foreign room. I've no control, you know me well. But I can feel it, I feel it. Every hour it takes you further away from me. Every time I said I love you, it was real to me. So I wait by the phone. Though we agreed that you won't come, maybe you'll find yourself back where we were. A parking Austin, precious time to kick the dirt. I know you'll see those birds in pairs. I wonder if you'll think of me. Thank you. I might do one more. Is that... Yep. Yeah? Okay, cool. Do you want a sad, sad one or an upbeat, sad one? Upbeat, sad's harder to play. Love a challenge? All right. All right. Is anyone here a pianist? Okay, no pianist themed gags then, I suppose. I will keep them to myself. Maybe I was right. Maybe I was wrong. I told my mom that I'm doing fine, then I miss when I get home. Trying to do the right thing by you, it didn't get me very far. What do you do when the best thing is the worst thing in disguise? When did I lose my mind? Maybe on the New York Times. Our backs against the wall, two hearts against it all. I'm asking all my friends, I don't want this to end. But
and I can't take the heat.
So much. Thanks for sticking around. I know, thank you. I appreciate it. And I want to say a big thank you to Sam and everybody who put this panel together. It's been really fun. So thank you.